Yes.
Which
Can you
is
see my
gonna be
screen?
on gallium nitride waveguide polariton lasers, which is obviously very different from standard ridge laser, and we're gonna hear about that.
Do you see my screen? Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So it's nice to follow Jesus as a speaker because there is a great continuity between our two talks. So here, this is a work that was performed at the University of Montpellier with my colleagues Christelle Brimont and Laetitia Doyennet. Sorry, I have a problem with my mouse. Yes. And the students, Chaka Guy, and the PhD student, Hassan Swissi, just starting. And this is a collaboration, as we said, with the CREA in Valbonne and Jesus, Sophie Bouchoul, and especially Maxime Gromovy at C2N, who did a lot on this the work I will be presenting, and the group of Joël Lemarié, Guillaume Alpech, Dimitri Sonnichkov in Clermont-Ferrand. So the motivations are the following. We want to integrate our waveguide polariton lasers and to make them nice micro lasers for integrated photonics. And this is why we switch it from vertical to waveguide polariton lasers. And here in the present work, I will also show that it's nice to switch from natural cavities where cracks are forming the mirrors to a top-down design. So I will spend some time on the sample design, on the way we operate the laser. Then I will discuss the Fabry-Pérot cavity, the strong coupling, and I will end up with a textbook illustration of the difference between the polariton laser and the semiconductor ridge laser that we can propose here. So coming back to the state of the art, Jesus did a presentation of it just before, but I would like to distinguish two things in the field of waveguide polarotonics. First of all, the nonlinearities, and in the work by Walker and in the group of Krasinovsky, they have shown that they can exploit here the negative dispersion and the slow light effect here to create a self-focusing nonlinearity leading to bright temporal solitons with some of the smallest energy per pulse ever obtained for such bright solitons in any photonic system. And if you want to go to room temperature, then you need wide bandgap materials or maybe TMDs or maybe organic excitons in order to go to larger couplings, temperature stability. And the first attempt was in the group of Nicolas Grandjean at EPFL on indium gallium nitride quantum wells. Here is the dispersion that they measured up to 100K. And more recently, the two groups from EPFL and Sheffield explored nonlinear pulse modulation in this system. Second field is the buildup of waveguide polariton lasers. And so Jesus just told us a lot about it. And the first demonstration was in a zinc oxide waveguide 2 years ago in Clermont-Ferrand. So here in our work, we will start from a gallium nitride and aluminum gallium nitride waveguide on a sapphire substrate, but it could be silicon substrates, gallium nitride substrate. We have a monomode vertical confinement. And compared to the last talk, we will also engineer the transverse confinement of the light. So we will etch down a ridge laser with a typical width of 1 micron so that we can hold a few transverse modes. And then at the end of this ridge, we will put DBRs, gallium nitride air DBRs with deep etching and 1 to 4 pairs. So we have cavities like that. The length is between 5 and 100 micron, and we have DBRs at the end. How do we operate this laser? We shine the cavity with a stripe-shaped excitation spot. This is a pulse laser, but with long pulses, so it is almost a quasi-CW pumping. We pump at 355 nanometer, very close to the exciton reservoir, so we don't have too hot carriers in the system. And we can change the length of the pump from, let's say, 5% to 100% of the cavity length. Then we do the imaging in a microscope. It's a micro-PL setup. And so here is the image of the cavity in the microscope. This one is 60 micron long. And we see on the CCD, horizontally, it's a spectrum. Vertically, it's the position of the emission. We see a very strong emission from the exciton reservoir here because the spot is here. and this is saturating the false colors here, so that we can see at the end of the cavity the signal coming from the DBRs acting as scatterers for the polariton light. And all the spectra we will present in the following slides are extracted at the position of the DBR, and they are just related to polariton. And we see that in between there is no light because the polariton propagate under the light cone. So how does the spectra look like? Below threshold, we have Fabry-Perot modes like here in this black spectrum here. And as we increase the pump power, we will see one, two, or three modes. So it's monomodulating at threshold and then a few modes appearing as we increase the power. We have a very steep nonlinear increase of the emission. And we have spectral narrowing, but as in the case of zinc oxide, as shown by Jesus Miguel Perez just before, this is difficult to see the modes that are lasing below threshold. Usually we don't see them because they are almost at zero detuning. They are broadened due to the excitonic content of the polariton modes that broadens homogeneously the modes. So in fact, we see the modes at negative detuning here. Their line width is typically 1 mEV here. The line width of the lasing modes is only 0.5 mEV in that case here with a high resolution spectrum. And so we can say that we have spectral narrowing because of that. How can we qualify the cavity, the Fabry-Perot cavity? First of all, here is a series of spectra as a function of the number of pairs in the DBR. 1, 2, 3, 4 pairs in the DBR. We see that the modes get sharper and sharper, showing that we have nice reflectors. And then in order to extract the coefficient of thinness of the cavity, we will normalize the spectra to the envelope of the spectrum so that we get some kind of a Fabry-Perot transmission spectrum here. And we will fit it with a standard expression for the Fabry-Perot transmission, extracting a coefficient of thinness here of 5 ±1, which is simply related in an empty cavity to the reflection coefficient of the DBRs. However, here we work with polaritons, so we have to account for the absorption of the light along the propagation. So R becomes R exponential minus alpha times the length of the cavity. And therefore we can put numbers on this. We will, and we see that from our fits, we see that we have the standard refractive index contrast between gallium nitride and air, and we have losses that are at negative detuning of the order of 400 inverted centimeters, which is consistent with an exciton homogeneous broadening of less than a mEV at 70 Kelvin. Okay, let's go to the strong coupling and the way we can prove it. So last year in Suzdal at PLMCN, I was showing how the gratings on a waveguide allow to directly measure the dispersion in K-space. And we analyze this within a few models, and this was just, this is available on archive and just accepted to field have applied. But here we cannot work on the dispersion, so we have to rely on the free spectral range of the cavity. So in a standard simple way of interpreting the dispersion, we have the photon line, which is usually non-dispersive in a waveguide, the exciton line, we get the lower polariton branch and upper polariton branch. But in a cavity, the wave vector is quantified, and therefore the free spectral range will somehow be proportional to the first derivative of the lower polariton branch dispersion, which is shown here. And zero detuning would occur here. Okay, this is a very simple scheme, coupled oscillators. And as discussed before, we have developed a much more elaborate model showing that, in fact, in dashed line, you have here in red dashed line, the true dispersion of the bare photon mode without excitons. And therefore, here we see that the Rabi splitting of such a waveguide is only 80 mEV, where the standard coupled oscillator model would give you much larger numbers, which are not non-physical. We measure the free spectral range of our cavity as shown here as a function of the energy, and we see that the free spectral range reduces across zero detuning that we can assess the rabbit splitting of about 80 milliEV. And moreover, we can assess that as we go across the threshold, we have the same dispersion. So we have a robust strong coupling across lasing threshold. And finally, we can estimate the excitonic fraction of the lasing mode, which is 65%. So it's a polariton laser with a positive detuning. And this is nice because here it's positive detuning and it's on a length that is 20 to 60 micron for the cavity. So we should imagine the wave function of the excitons the excitonic component of the polariton wave function extending over the whole cavity, mostly excitonic. Okay, I say that I would revisit the way that we compare polariton lasers and the standard lasers. And in a standard semiconductor laser, in fact, we have to come back to the Bernard-Dura-4 condition, which is illustrating the reciprocity between absorption and emission and stimulated emission in the spectra. So when we plot the absorption to the bottom or the gain to the top spectrum of a bulk semiconductor laser, we have an absorption which is increasing as a square root of the energy minus the energy of the gap here. And then when we increase the carrier density, we increase the Fermi levels for electron and holes. And when we reach degeneracy, like here, when the difference between the Fermi level of the electron and holes is larger than the gap, this is the Bernard-Dura-4 condition, then we reach the population inversion in the system. But the gain cannot be larger than the opposite of the absorption. So in a multi-section laser, this one here, if the injection of current is taking place only in two of the five sections of this laser, so the length of the injection is smaller than half of the cavity length, then it's impossible to get lasing because the losses on the remaining sections will be larger than the absorption, than the gain on the two injected laser sections. So in fact, in a multi-section laser, we see that gain is larger than loss only if we inject over more than half the cavity. And this is what we can do with our optical pumping in our system. We can play with the length of the pump, and we see that we can see lasing even for cavity a pump length, which is 10% of the cavity length. And the threshold is shown here as a function of the cavity length, of the pump length. So this is a 60 micron cavity. We can pump the full cavity and the threshold will be of the order of half a nanojoule per pulse. And then if we go down to 10% of the cavity length, then we will have a 3 times increase of the pump power. So this is not related to exciton diffusion because we have probed through imaging the size of the exciton reservoir and it's almost the one of the pump. So it's really because of the decorrelation between absorption in the part which is not pumped and gain from stimulated relaxation from the excitonic reservoir that we can explain the fact that we pump, we lase with 10% of the cavity length that is excited. And this is really a textbook-like illustration of the difference between a standard semiconductor laser and a polariton laser. Just to finish, a few words about the temperature dependence. Here it's on a 20 micron cavity, and we show that we can increase the temperature up to 220 Kelvin, still seeing lasing modes at threshold. However, we have a 3 orders of magnitude increase of the threshold, which is related to the fact that there is no minimum in energy, as explained by Jesus just before. There is no minimum of energy for the polariton branch. So the higher the temperature, the lower the polariton can relax along the branch, and it's harder and harder to get a narrow gain spectrum. So this is why Dmitry Solnishkov and Guillaume Malpech predicted 6 years ago that the optimal temperature for gallium nitride is about 50 Kelvin, and this is where we observe low threshold here. Let me summarize now. We have demonstrated a top-down approach to design the gallium nitride waveguide polariton lasers. We illustrate the difference between a polariton laser and a standard semiconductor laser in a nice way, I think. And we have a new playground for polariton physics with controlled cavities, control of the transverse modes, of the pumping schemes, and nonlinearities that are very interesting. And we are just working on the electrical injection. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Thierry. It's time for questions. Yeah, Paul, you have a question.
Thanks, Jerry, for a really fascinating talk. I was just wondering if you had a feel for what the internal power you can generate in your laser is, just with a view, if it's high enough, then perhaps it could be coupled to a section to generate some nonlinear effects.
Yeah, this is a very nice question. I took the numbers from your papers to see how many photons are propagating in a soliton and how we can compare it with what's going on in our cavities. And I think within a factor 100, we are on the same orders of magnitude and maybe changing the length of the cavity, changing the pump length, we can reach conditions where solitons could form or harmonic mode locking could take place in our system. I don't know. It's really something that is on the edge of what we are looking at right now. And I suppose this is the way you, the kind of thing you wanted to hear.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Great. Thanks. Alexei, you had a question?
Yes. So I have a philosophical question here. So definitely waveguides have several advantages with respect to vertical cavities. It's simpler, right? Do not need to grow such a thick break mirrors. And but then if we go this way, what do you think about microwires, micro roads, where whispering gallery modes would be coupled to excitons? It looks like it is even simpler from the technology point of view, and then there are already proofs in zinc oxide that it works. So why not to make an electrically injected polariton laser on a gallium nitride microwire?
On a microwire, there may be problems with the transverse modes, but on a nanowire, where it's almost a fiber, then I'm sure everything is polaritonic in nature, and we should revisit the works by Zimmler maybe 12 years or 14 years ago, understanding how their lasing was polaritonic, and even with electrical injection. But the problem with electrical injection is usually that the doping is degrading the line width of the excitonic transition, and the strong coupling could be broken. So then it's more on the technological side that we have to choose the best geometry. But you're right, the wires are nice for that. Nanowires for sure are polariton lasers and compatible with electrical injection. I'm not sure.
Nanowires require cavities still. In a microwire, if you have a coupling of a whispering gallery mode, you do not need any mirrors at all, and quality factor can be high. So potentially, if you manage to do some doping on one side and then doping on the other side, that might be the way, I think, no?
Yes, maybe Jesus could answer a bit about that, because he worked a lot on that.
We have a PhD on that, working exactly on that, to get a micro electrically injected microwire, gallium nitride microwire polariton laser. In principle, it might seem simpler. In practice, it's not so simple. And the fact is that your whispering gallery mode will overlap with your doped, highly doped regions. And then, it's not complete compared to the planar structure, where we can very nicely control the thicknesses and we can use all we know about growth for the microwires, controlling the exact thicknesses and the geometry of the injection is not so easy. So we have a PhD on that, but what might seem simpler in theory, it's technologically very difficult. But we have a PhD on that, exactly on that, getting an electrically injected gallium nitride microwire laser.
I see. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, I do not see further questions. So thank you very much, Yuri. And